challenged me the other day. He said, I want you, in order to find the story, behind the story of what happened to you, I want you to interview your family. And I'm like, you want me to what? Yes. You're gonna become a reporter. You're gonna ask the who, what, where, when, why questions. Because see, a lot of my story, there's just empty spaces, and you'll find out why that is. And so I really need them to tell me, what was I like? What happened? How did I end up in that psychiatric hospital? Because I don't remember. So let's go back to yesterday. Ancient history, right? Let's go back to yesterday. I interview my mother. Right, exactly. My heart is pounding as I share this with you. So we spend an hour and a half talking. And I ask my mom, what was I like as a child? When did you start seeing the signs of my mental health condition before anybody knew what it was? What about my teenage years? What about after some traumatic events that I'm about to tell you about? Because I wanted to hear it from her perspective, and she confirmed a lot of what I internalized. And also, from her perspective, there was a lot missing because she couldn't get inside my mind and my heart and my inner world, which is what was separating me from the rest of the world. See, I grew up in a pretty typical family. If you want to say, you know, mom, dad, country home, walk-in closet, lots of clothes, dad, successful, kind, mom, overprotective, Christian school, knee-high socks, horseback riding lessons, piano lessons. So I have this structure in my childhood, this safety in my childhood. I had two older brothers. I was the only girl. I was the baby of the family. I got everything I wanted. My mom, if I was sad because my dad wouldn't come home from work, she'd go out and buy me a new wardrobe. I mean, how hard is that childhood to get through, right? But there was an emptiness inside of me because I never could connect with the one person that I needed the most. And it wasn't my mom, and it wasn't my friends. It was my father. I needed my father more than anybody, because most little girls do. The father-daughter relationship defines how they're gonna feel about themselves. Well, I took that not coming home personally, because children tend to do that, right? They're egocentric, everything is about them. What have I done wrong? How can I control my world? So they start showing signs of behaviors. Well, for me, I was extremely emotional. Nothing's changed. Extremely emotional and dramatic. And I would have these big temper tantrums when I throw myself on the floor in the store, I mean, which is actually kind of typical at the same time, but I literally couldn't calm myself down. I had no self-regulation at all. And I remember I was in infancy. I was so upset at whatever it was that I would actually stand up on my mom's lap. And I'm like 3 months old. I never stopped. So they started giving me sedative, a little phenobarbital, and I was a whole new person. Well, that would not be the last time in my life that I would become medicated. When I was about 11, I was active in my church, and it was one of those really charismatic churches where they had the flags and they're speaking in tongues and they're like, and prophecy and all the works, you know? That's what we had, that's how I grew up. And I remember going to this mother-daughter event, and there was there's worship dancers. And I remember watching them and being almost like hypnotized by the movement. The beauty, the flow, the artistry, the color. And something inside me was like, I want that. I want to do that. There's something about that that makes sense to me. So I said, Mom, I want to take dance classes. She says, okay, honey, right? Because that's what Mom did. Okay, honey, whatever you want. So I started taking dance classes, and I started taking ballet at 11 years old. And I remember when I stepped up to the bar, see, I can't even help it, I go to first position. Dancers laugh. inside clicked. It was like I literally came home, I found where I belong. I started dancing once a week, but of course it wasn't enough for me. Mom, I want to take more classes. The teachers are like, oh, you're awfully good. You catch on so quickly. Maybe you need to go to a classical ballet school. So I left the one school, I went to a new one, trained there. Mrs. Morrison from the Washington Ballet, who was the owner of the school, said, you are extremely talented. You might want to think about a pre-professional classical ballet school. I had only been dancing for 2 years. And I was like, hell yeah. I'm moving away from home, right? I'm doing this. I was driven. I was drawn to dance, particularly ballet, because I was a perfectionist. Oh, I loved it when they wanted everything perfect, because so did I. And it fit, and I was successful, and I was loved, and I was praised. But unfortunately, that also reinforced my performance-oriented approval. My dad came to every show. He drove down on weekends to take me and my friends out to dinner, paint my dorm room, do whatever I wanted. He wanted to be part of my life. He bragged about me to his friends. You know, how many fathers are gonna say, my daughter is gonna be a professional ballerina? And he was so proud. I remember Petrus Bosman from the Royal Ballet, who owned the school. He met me and he just fell in love. He called me number 9, because that was my audition number. Told me number 9 the entire time I was there. And I felt connected to my peers. We all had the same goal. We all wanted to be professional dancers. We were all sacrificing everything for it. It's like going into athletics at a very young age, training for the Olympics. That is your life. I was connected and fulfilled. But unfortunately, my body started breaking down. 6 hours a day, 7-8 hours a day during shows, 6 days a week. My young, developing body was starting to question its ability to keep up with the pressure. See, mentally, I was extremely competitive. My mom confirmed that yesterday. You were extremely competitive, and you had to be in order to be number 1. And they moved you right to the top because of it. But it was in that competitiveness that I sacrificed part of myself, because I didn't care how hard I pushed. I wanted success. And I remember my mom started getting concerned. She told me this yesterday. She said, I sat down with the owners of the school after the second year, and I said, I'm concerned because my daughter's body is falling apart. Her knees are starting to go bad. I don't know if this is worth it. But I kept going. And in the spring of 1994, I was an understudy for a lead swan. You know swans. Everybody knows that. For almost everybody. And then if you don't know it, I'm just... And she got a stress fracture the night before the show. And it's very common to get stress fractures in ballet. She's like, yeah. It's just like, oh, you got a stress fracture. All right. No big deal. So I'm on, right? I knew her parts, my parts, and nailed it. Yesterday, my mom confirmed that that show was absolutely amazing. And I remember it being amazing. And I remember feeling on top of the world. And I remember Petrus looking at me like, you have met my expectations. You have surpassed my expectations. You're going to be a star. I remember he asked me, are you willing to do whatever it takes to become Margot Fonteyn or the next Margot Fonteyn? Because you might have to sacrifice for that. You might have to have a couple of hip replacements before the age of 30. But are you willing to do that? Because it's right here in front of you. Just take it. And I was like, hell yeah. I am not afraid of sacrifice. I'm not afraid of pain. I'm not afraid of physical pain or emotional pain. So I went for it. Well, unfortunately, with all of that awesomeness on stage, the next morning I woke up and I couldn't move. I was in excruciating pain. I called my mom. Mom called Petrus. They sent me to the best orthopedic doctor in Washington, D.C. And I'll never forget the moment in that hospital room or in that doctor's office when he was looking at the x-ray screen and I saw the inside of my body for the first time. And I remember thinking to myself, I I can see my failure. I can see my broken parts. And he turned around and he said, you have degenerative disc disease. You have arthritis in your spine. You have 3 herniated discs on your lower back. You have the spine of a 40-year-old and you're only 17. I'm sorry, but you're never gonna dance again. And I remember something inside of me broke. And if I'm completely honest with you, 25 years later, it's never been put back together. Part of my journey is allowing that to be what it is. So, the story I've been telling my audiences up until now was that I stopped dancing and I went home. My mother reminded me that I didn't. I kept going. I was gonna prove him wrong. So I kept dancing, I kept pushing. I couldn't hold a 45 degree arabesque, which is basically this thing. I couldn't hold that without pain, but I didn't care because I was gonna push through that and I was gonna show them that I could do this no matter what. But about the end of the year, again, my mom intervened. She brought Petros, David Keener, all the other professional dancers from all over the world who came to train us, and she said, enough is enough. It's not worth it. You broke my daughter. I'm pulling her out. I was pissed. I remember she pulling me out. I went back home. The hardest part of that was that instead of continuing to invest in my life, my dad went back to work. I guess there was no reason for him to continue showing up on the weekends. I internalized that, I perceived that as rejection. So not only did I lose my dream, the first love, but I perceived that I lost my father. In a lot of ways I did. I had to change schools. So I had to go from like a school that really we were just going doing academics because you had to, but we only did it till noon. And then we'd go dance the rest of the day. And everybody else were like, you have to do academics. You know, we live to dance. Well, here I had to go back to like 7 or 8 hours of school, you know, and then I'd ask the peers, I'd say, what do you guys do with your free time? Oh, we hang out. And I'm like, what's that? Like, how do you do that? How do you do nothing? Because I'm like constantly moving here. I remember I found myself in another doctor's office being wrapped in these wet strips of cloth that would harden and make a brace. I was being casted for a brace to keep my spine from moving because I literally like had to freeze my spine. And I remember part of my memoir, I was writing about how when they froze my physical body, I felt like they were freezing all my emotions in that brace as well. And if it wasn't for that brace, I would have just burst into a million pieces. And I wore it all day. And see, here we go, a little bit of context. I lived in an old-fashioned, like, Civil War town. In the western hills of Maryland. I mean, there were like Civil War walls in the woods. They would even do reenactments down the middle of a main street. You know, it was a volunteer fire department. There were rolling hills and, you know, watermelon farmers or whatever. You know, there weren't very many pre-professional classical ballet dancers coming home from school after a career-ending spinal injury. It just didn't happen. So I remember my mom again confirmed yesterday, you are different than everybody else. And they were like, what are you doing back home? And I'm like, I don't want to talk about it. Why don't you dance again? What was it like not living with your parents? Did you party? I didn't have time for that. This was the best. When they walk up to my brace, because high schoolers are so nice. Right? Knock on my brace. You call me Ace of Brace. Because back then, I mean, way back then, it was like Ace of Base was the really popular band. So I'm like, thank you so much, I feel special. Let's pull out all my vulnerability. Let me just dump it all on the floor in front of you so you can stomp on it. Thank you, peers. And it just furthered my like isolation, my feeling of not being able to connect and being different. With all of that, I didn't know how to process it. My brain was like, okay, this is an overload. I'm gonna shove it down and I'm gonna try to avoid all the pain and all the loss and all the discomfort. I'm gonna bury it and then I'm just gonna move on. But unfortunately, the depression set in. My mom started noticing I was isolating. I was trying to move on with my life, but there was this darkness growing inside of me that I couldn't run from. She tried to keep me happy. For the first couple of years after dance, I was extremely moody, up and down. And I'm not talking sad, happy. I'm talking rage, irritability, worthless, shame, guilt. Those are the symptoms that you can't see in an adolescent who's struggling with mental health. You can't necessarily see their hopelessness or their worthlessness or their guilt or shame, but those are the symptoms. Physically, I hit it all really well. If you look back at my pictures, I look like a successful, popular, happy teenage girl. I wore a mask. I was an actress. It worked really well for a while until I was 19 years old. I graduated from high school and I had a choice to make. My mom reminded me that I had to either move with her to the beach because they sold the country home. My brothers moved away from home. We were done being in the country. I could live with her or I could live with my dad in Virginia and I could study college and I could study drama and pursue my dream of acting, because at that point I had to do something with all my artistic frustration, you know. I just didn't have a place to express it. I needed to be on stage. If you can't already tell, that's probably where I belong, right? But I'd have to live with my dad. And I couldn't stomach the fact that I would have to live with I felt rejection every day. So I decided right then to walk away from everything. Another thing that helped me do that was a voice inside my head that said, you're not good enough. That if you allow your body to change from a dancer physique to a typical girl, that you failed. It said to me that, you know, if you could just keep the dancer body, that you could stay happy. You could have all that stuff. Remember, Amy, all that stuff that you had at VSA and in dance? You hold on to that, you hold on to your dancer body, and you'll be happy. And I believed it. So I became obsessed with my weight. I became obsessed with numbers. I remember my mom reminded me yesterday, I tried to control what she ate. And I was like, I did? She's like, yeah, you did. Yeah. So I moved away. Nobody knew me at the beach. So I could hide it all. Nobody knew that I was a former dancer, so I didn't get questions. But the anxiety and the depression wouldn't go away. The darkness and the obsessive thoughts about my weight started taking over my life. I was found on the floor of my condo in 1990, doesn't matter. My brother found me. I had a panic attack, so severe, I literally couldn't see anything, I couldn't hear anything, but the raging voice inside my head that says, you can't do this anymore, you can't do this anymore, you can't do this anymore. He walked in, he found me there, they quickly called a hotline, and they got me into an inpatient treatment center. They did the right thing. They didn't know what to do, so they called a hotline. I spent a week there. I was diagnosed with obsessive compulsive disorder. Can you believe that? Me? Obsessive? They nailed it. But I wasn't just obsessive. They hadn't really found the undiagnosed eating disorder and something else. That took about 4 more years. And if you read through my journals, which I'm not going to let you, but I'll just tell you, I'll fill you in on what they said. I was so unstable that when I read back through them to write in the memoir, I'm like, okay, I feel so sorry for this girl. She is so hurting. She's so lost. I can't help her. As the narrator of this book, I wish I could go back and help her. Maybe I will by writing her words and honoring them. By the age of 24, I was trying to be normal like everybody else, right? Because I wanted to be normal. Instead, hell, I wasn't. I was extremely moody. Every emotion was magnified by 100. You know, like my friends would, if they went through a breakup, you know, the boyfriend broke up with them, they would just go get a new boyfriend, right? My boyfriend broke up with me, I wanted to kill myself. It's just like an event and then an extreme reaction. And that's because of my mental health condition. It wasn't because I was weak, and it didn't mean that I was, you know, not being able to handle life. But we didn't know that till I was 25. I was holding it together, I had a job, and I was doing the caffeine cigarette diet pill diet. That one that's gonna kill me real fast. And I remember being at work and I collapsed on the floor in the bathroom. I was feeling dizzy and it went black. I woke up, my boss is wheeling me into the emergency room. And I'm like, oh, the cat's out of the bag. All my secrets that I have kept hidden are for everybody to see. They hooked me up to sticky patches and tubes in my arms, and I was laying there in the hospital bed, and I remember my best friend was holding my left hand. And the doctor, ER doctors are so understanding, and they have the best bedside manners. Because they're never in a hurry to get you in and out, right? And they don't want to get to know you. So he walks in with his clipboard, and he's like, okay, you have two choices. And I'm like, here it comes. He says, you can keep going like you're going and most likely die. Or you could stop, get help, and most likely live. And I remember being like, are you kidding me? Those are the two choices? Like, what if I don't want those two choices? What if I want to live in the in-between? What if I want to be like half alive, half dead? You know, which is what I've been doing my whole entire life. I want to die, but I'm stuck alive. That was my reality. He wouldn't let me live in it anymore without giving me an ultimatum, damn him. So I'm obviously standing in front of you, so I gave it a shot. I said, fine. I didn't run through the treatment center doors like, this is going to be the best. Fine, I'm going to go get better, you know? It was like, fine, I'll try it. Okay? But you're wrong, but I'll try it. $20,000 later, 3 days later, and 2,500 miles away, I checked into Ramuda Ranch, which is a faith-based eating disorder treatment center, because they thought I had an eating disorder. They were foolish. And sure enough, I did. I had bulimia. And then the darkness, had a name. It was bipolar disorder. Bipolar 2 disorder, actually. I'm like, bipolar 2? Bipolar? Like, that sounds bad. What is that? That sounds serious. I can kind of handle bulimia, because I've heard of it. He started putting me on medicine, and yesterday my mom said, oh my gosh, you are a different person. And she smiled. And I'm like, what was wrong with me before? She was like, no, Amy, you were like this. You know? And I'm thinking, you're welcome? But that was my journey. That was the beginning of the journey. I stayed there for 3 months. I skimmed the surface of being angry at my dad. Maybe dealing a little bit with the pain and rejection. But I never really went back to the root. So me and my eating disorder left that treatment center together. And I remember I relapsed about 1 year afterward. And I felt like, what's wrong with me? I can't even do recovery right. I was such a perfectionist. I didn't realize that recovery is a journey. You just work through it. It's not a straight line. If you know someone who's in recovery, it'll probably look like this. That's the way recovery works. It's messy. It's unpredictable at times. It took me a long time to realize that. It also took me a long time to accept my illness as part of me. See, when I got my diagnosis, actually, I was more relieved than angry, because not me, okay? So therefore, there's a space now for me to fight it, for me to live well, and I did the best that I could. I fell in love, I got married, I started college, and I got pregnant. And I remember nobody said anything about what pregnancy was like for a woman with bipolar disorder. It was fantastic. I was no longer bipolar. The pregnancy hormones balanced everything out. My parents said, "Would you just stay pregnant?" I'm like, "No, thanks, I love you too." And I remember when I found out that I was gonna have a baby, the first thing I thought of after I'm gonna have a baby is, I'm gonna get fat. Not, I'm growing a child in my womb. You know, I am going to have offspring. No, it was, oh my God, I'm gonna get fat. Does Weight Watchers have a pregnancy plan? And I remember going to Babies R Us, and they gave me a gun. They gave like a zapper thing, and they just told me, just zap everything, and people will buy it for you. And I'm like, I can do this. So I zap everything, and then I go to the book that says what to expect when you're expecting, and I looked for a bipolar's guide to growing a human, and it wasn't in there. So nobody told me what was gonna happen after I gave birth. The glorious 9 months later, I suffered from what was called postpartum bipolar depression. Kind of a big deal. They sent me home, about 2 days after I had my baby, they sent me home with a bottle of pills and a baby. I could do the pills. I didn't know anything about babies. And it took my mom and my husband and my cousins and my husband's cousins' wives and everyone in our family to take care of me and the baby. Nobody knew what was going on. I was breaking apart. I remember laying in my bed covered in sweat and in fear and panic from anxiety. The hormones were leaving my body. My psychiatrist was MIA, by the way, which was like, could have sued him, but that's a whole other story. Nobody knew what was happening. I remember day four, they said, okay, well, your therapist got you in to a psychiatrist on a favor for a friend. That's how I got in. I walk in and I tell her what was going on from what I could verbalize, and she got out a brown paper bag full of samples. Try these. They might work. Or not. Those were the beginning of the years of being a guinea pig. When I look back on the first 4 or 5 years of my daughter's life, internally my memory is of darkness and of pain and of misery. But I graduated from college and had a full-time job at a crisis shelter. Like, there was this huge difference between my inner world and my outer world. I was like, you know, business casual, big mug of steaming coffee. Like, I'm a happy person, right? But the inside, I just wanted to step off a curb. I just wanted, you know, I'm like, I remember writing in my journal, I can't, you know, kill myself because I got errands to run. Who'd pick up the kid from daycare? But it got to the point in 2010, something very big happened, very big. My back went out. It relapsed, and all that physical pain from the initial injury flooded to the surface, and all the emotional pain came with it. Because our emotional pain can get trapped in our body, in our physical body. It all came rushing to the surface, and I couldn't handle it. And my mind had one solution, and only one solution, which was suicide. That was it. Nobody could talk me out of it. I remember in my journal, the shame was so intense. I remember writing, your husband would be better off with another wife. Your daughter would be better off with another mother. You're worthless. And if you don't lose 10 pounds, then you're even more worthless. The eating disorder was screaming at me, and the darkness was closing in. See, when somebody is suffering from that level of illness in their brain, which you can actually physically see on an MRI, by the way. They need help as soon as possible. Well, unfortunately, I couldn't be left alone for very long. There was one instance I was alone in my condo. Annabelle was at daycare. She was like, was she 3 or 4? Tim was at work. That's my husband's name, Tim, by the way. And I'm just pacing back and forth, pacing back and forth. And I remember stockpiling pills. All the psychiatric medication that they ever given me, I stored it in the back of my medicine cabinet or underneath my counter. I don't know why, but I did. That's a sign, by the way. Stockpiling pills or looking for weapons. Those are two really big signs. So I got all those out to make use of them. Added a bottle of Tylenol just for the hell of it. I was not in touch with reality, and I remember walking back and forth, and I ended up at the refrigerator, and I look up, and I see a hotline magnet. And I'm like, where did that come from? I didn't put that there. The hotline magnet fairy came and just stuck it on my fridge, or maybe it was my husband. Somebody did. And there was a voice inside of me that I hadn't heard in a really long time, and it said, call. And I just picked up the phone and I dialed it and I didn't even think twice. And I remember a guy answers the phone, just this random dude. And he's like, hey, you know, what's going on? And I'm like, and I started telling him what was going on. He convinced me, he persuaded me to not do anything stupid on the phone. He didn't use that word. But he, you know, promised me not to hurt myself while we were on the phone. He got me to promise him I wouldn't hang up. He got me to promise him that I would go somewhere safe. He was very good at his job. I ended up going somewhere safe, and it was my mom's house. I remember crawling into the bed that I would sleep in as a child. I laid on my side, and she read me a storybook. I was like a little girl again. My mommy was comforting me, and I was so afraid, but I didn't know what I was afraid of. The book was called Grover's The Monster at the End of This Book by Sesame Street. Who knows Grover, the furry monster? He's just so adorable, right? Well, the whole plot of the book is that he doesn't want you to finish the book because there's a monster at the end of the book, and he's afraid of monsters. So who's read it? Anybody? So every time you turn the page, he's like, don't turn the page, and we'll build a brick wall, you know? And then you turn the page, and it's like, you turn the page, and he totally freaks out. And I remember freaking out with him each page, and my eyes are glued to the page. By the end of the book, he realized, oh, there's nothing to fear. I am the monster. And I remember thinking, I don't have anything afraid. I am the monster. This is something inside of me. And it's going to kill me if I don't get help. So I checked myself into an inpatient psychiatric ward. They put me on very, very heavy medication to keep me safe. A dietitian came to see me. Now, this is kind of funny. She comes to see me because I had a diagnosed eating disorder. And she put out a plate. And she sat down. She's like, let's look at portions. And I want to be like, are you effing kidding me? Like, look, lady, eating disorders aren't about food. Teaching me to eat is not going to fix this situation. All right? So go home and I'll take your job and I'll teach everybody what eating disorders are really about. So I was discharged and I was still on a lot of heavy medication. And I remember feeling numb because they had no choice. They had to medicate me like that to keep me safe. One evening, I was sitting on the sofa, and I was watching David Letterman. And it was like the top 10, and it's funny. It's enjoyable. So here I am chilling, watching Letterman. And have you ever had a massage before, and it feels like, it, you know, just feels good to somebody massage you, right? Well, I remember I was really sore, and the side of my leg was even more sore for some reason. I don't know why. So I started massaging my leg, and it felt so good. And then a voice inside my head said, you know, if you push a little harder, it'll feel even better. So I pushed harder. And then the voice said, you know, if you use something to push, it would feel even better. So I went and I got this massage tool, wooden massage tool. I was a massage therapist for a long time. I did trigger point therapy. So there was a little wooden tool with a nub, and I rubbed it on my leg, and sure enough, it was right. It felt so much better. I felt a tingling sensation go through my body and a release. Letterman was over, I went to bed, no big deal. I woke up the next morning to my husband leaning over my bed going, "What the heck is that?" And I'm like, "What?" You know, "What day is it?" And I looked down and I had dug a hole in the side of my leg. And I don't remember feeling anything except for that release. What I came to learn later is that self-harm is about that chemical release. It is addictive. You think you can control it, but it starts to control you. A lot of people with self-harm describe it as a boiling pot, and the behavior lifts the lid a little bit to let the pressure out. Maybe that's what I was doing. I found a very, I would say, smart, compassionate therapist who taught me that food wasn't a feeling, that feelings weren't food. Feelings weren't food? She says, "Yes, Amy, fat isn't a feeling." I was like, "Oh, I'm screwed." Because that's all I've been able to feel for like 20 years. So she says, "Okay, Amy, so if you take out fat, then what's I feel, fill in the blank?" That's what happens with eating disorders. You get confused. Fat becomes the feeling of choice. But if you remove fat, what do you get? I feel angry, I feel scared, I feel lost, I feel hopeless. Mine was angry. She taught me how to feel my feelings without food. I found a dietitian that taught me that it wasn't my enemy, that it was okay to eat. I found a psychiatrist who weaned me off all of those heavy antipsychotics and found the right balance for me that no longer damaged my body and that went with the therapy, because pills aren't the answer. You know, the medication is not the, "Oh, good, go on meds and you're fixed." No, medication is this. You're learning to sail a ship in the middle of the ocean and there's a huge storm. Medication calms the storm so you can learn how to sail through life. The medication calms the storm so that you can learn to cope and learn to use your skills. That's all it does. It's a piece of the puzzle. I found that piece. I found the right therapist. It was like the perfect storm, I guess you'd say. For years and years and years, I ran from wellness. I chose a lot of times to stay sick because that was safe to me. I pushed so many people away who were trying to help me. So don't be surprised when you try to intervene and reach out to young people and they push you away consistently. My advice to you is continue to show up. Continue to ask. Earn the right to be heard, because they will listen. It was the perfect storm. I remember therapists aren't really supposed to tell people what to do. They're supposed to reflect back to you and maybe help you figure it out, right? This day, this Saturday morning, I will never forget, October 2011, Saturday morning, sitting on the sofa, and she's sitting across from me. She says, "Amy, you need to go back and grieve your loss of dance. You never have." And I was like, "That's the truth. That's the truth. That's the truth out of all the lies. That's the truth out of all the running away. That's the root. That was the last thing that I wanted to do." My mom's a very smart woman. I got this on tape, Mom. Yes, you are a very smart woman. Because what she did, yes, I said it. Don't say I never did. She was afraid I would burn everything. All my tutus and all my shoes and everything. So she stored it all in a box with a purple lid. Leotards, tights, everything she could fit down in there, and she sealed it up and kept it for years and years and years. I remember I was meeting with her at a Starbucks. My dad was there too, but he was behind a newspaper. Typical, right? Dad. And I said, "You know, my therapist wants me to go back and grieve the loss of dance. I never have." And she just kind of went white.
he's going to grieve. This is going to get messy. And she says, well, I got something to tell you. I kept everything. And I'm like, what? She says, I kept everything. Everything. Your last pair of shoes, your leotards, your tights, everything. And I'm like, okay, give it back and let me deal with this. She's like, okay.
She didn't really want to give it back to me. She's like, okay, I'm here to pick you up when you're done.
I go home. I remember grabbing my phone and turning it on the classical music station, because up until that point, I couldn't even hear classical music without having a panic attack. But I needed to bring it all back. In that way where you need to cry, so you listen to every sad song and you go back to like high school. Like, why did they invite me to that party? You bring it all back up so you can get it all out. Well, that's what I tried to do in this experience. I got the classical music, I got a bottle of wine, because, you know, and I'm sitting on my living room floor, and I open up the box, and this smell rises up out of the box because it's sweat and old pointe shoes that have been trapped for 20 years. You must have been a dancer. Stank, okay? It was the most beautiful smell because I recognized those fragrances. I picked up the wool ballet warm-up, and I could feel it on my fingertips. And those sensations brought all of the emotions back up to the surface. And I remember pain ripped through my chest, and I broke open and I wept. I grieved the loss of the one thing that I've ever truly loved. I had to. You're talking about ripping open a scab. You're talking about looking at stuff in the face that you haven't seen in 25 years. Let me tell you something. What you wanted in life is right on the other side of your fear. What I wanted in life was on the other side of that experience. And I finally wanted to live more than I was afraid of it. So I dug through the box. And after I was done weeping, I started laughing. Like cracking up laughing, because all the memories came back. But me and my roommates, we were all wanted to be like Broadway superstars too. So we had all these Broadway posters, and we were laying on the floor. We're like doing our sit up, you know, like bright lights. All that stuff came back, all the good and the bad. And I allowed myself to lose. I allowed myself to lose, so that I can get back my joy. I took it back. But first, I had to kick my eating disorder's ass. So this is what I did. I went into my bathroom, and I pulled out my scale, the demon that lived in the corner. You know, and the little red numbers in the glass. Bastards. I dragged that thing out to my back porch. I went over to the little storage thing door, and I opened it up, and there was a big sledgehammer. The one that had a really long handle, right? I had no business trying to use this thing. So I grab it and I drag it out of the closet, right? And I'm like, it's time, it's go time, right? So I get it up over my shoulder and I let it swing and I smash those numbers. And I did it again and I did it again until I was breathless and I was shaking and I was just, I don't remember what I was saying. It was just a bunch of junk. You robbed me of my life. You took away my joy from having a baby. You took away my marriage. You stole 18 years of my life. Center. I turn around and there's my 3-year-old little girl standing, looking through the glass door. And I'm like, oh God, how do you explain this? Parenting 101. Just be honest. Doesn't matter how young they are, just tell them the truth, okay? So I go open and I open the door and I get down to her level and I said, Annabelle, you probably aren't gonna remember this, hopefully. Numbers don't matter. This thing doesn't define you, who you are. Mommy's gonna take care of herself now, and I love you. I've never weighed myself again.
you that story because I want you to not know all about me, because I'm sure you're going to walk out here and be like, we know about Amy Waddle now. Yes. I hope that that was a mirror for you to see inside your own life. Did you see your dad? Did you see your mom? Did you see your hopes? Did you see your dreams? Did you see your cat? You know, whatever it was, that's what the most important thing is. So through my memoir, I'm continuing to heal and I'm continuing to hope that hope is stronger than fear. It's the only thing that can prevent suicide. So as you become educators, it is very important that you take the role of a hope builder, because the world is not gonna change. Just a heads up, okay? Heads up, it ain't getting better, okay? It's probably gonna get worse. The best thing that you can do for the people around you and your students is to help them to learn coping skills and build hope, decrease pain, increase hope. That's all you gotta do for suicide prevention, right? Increase that hope in their life. Encourage. So now I'm in the new section of my life. I became a QPR trainer. I'll never forget, QPR is the 3-step action plan to prevent suicide. I'll never forget when I found out what the steps were, I was like, oh, that's what that dude used on the phone with me. It was a technique. Now I get to teach it, which is a phenomenal feeling. And I also need to encourage people to reach out, not because there's other people in your life that can fix your problems, not because most likely they're not gonna have solutions to them. Sometimes there aren't answers. That's okay. Remember, life's messy, but you don't have to go through it alone. None of it. Stay connected with anybody, anything, a dog even. I love my cat, man. She is like, she's a pet therapy cat, but she has a mood disorder. Absolutely, I regulate her. The thing too, I want to end with this, and I think it's so important to remember, especially where you're at in your life, you are so much more than what you're doing in this room right now. You are so much more than your degree. You are so much more than your grades. You are so much more than your future plans. I wish I knew that when I lost ballet. I wish I knew that I was good enough and I was more than my talent. Because if you find that you're you and you are enough, then it doesn't matter what happens in life, you're already okay. But there's so much focus on success. Who gets stressed out? Who feels pressure? You don't have to raise your hand, but who's trying to feel good enough? I just want to remind you that you already are. And if I could make it through life to 41 years old, yes, I'm 41, and still be alive. My husband told me the other day after I told him, hey, by the way, I have to become a reporter and I have to interview you. And he's like, are you sure you want to do that? And I was like, yes, just tell me what I was like. Because I don't remember. It's so important to remember that we're stronger than we think. All right? We're so much stronger than we think. That is something you can remind your students over and over. You're so much stronger than you think. My daughter's 5. Or no, she was 5. She's still 5. No, she's 11. Okay? They grow up. Who knew? And I tell her every day, you're more than your grades, Annabelle. Grades? Who are you as a person? That is so, so important. So I would like to take about 5, maybe 10 minutes tops to open up for questions. I am completely, obviously, transparent. So you can ask me anything. It could be about my illness. It could be about mental health. It could be about suicide prevention. It could be about dance. Anything. I'd love the opportunity to answer your questions.
Now that Annabelle
is older, has the situation with the scale ever come up? Do you know if she remembers?
No, and I haven't asked. No, she, I don't know if she notices that we don't have scales in our house. We don't even talk about weight or anything. We're just like, hey, you know, eat until you're satisfied. We don't even use the word full, just eat until you're satisfied, and whatever food that you choose to eat at the moment, so you probably the what your body needs. And she's like, spaghetti for breakfast? And I'm like, damn straight. You want to have spaghetti for breakfast, go for it. High carb breakfast. Get through the day.
The three steps for the suicide prevention you're talking about, can you go into a little bit of like detail about that?
Yes. Question, persuade, refer. Question, are you thinking of suicide? Or are you thinking of ending your life? We don't use the word committed suicide because suicide's not a crime. So it's taking your own life. Are you thinking of taking your own life? That's ask the question. Regardless if you you know, think that they're going to get offended or whatever, it's just their life is so much more valuable than the friendship that you have with them, right? It's so important. And then persuade is, hey, I want you here. You're important. That's the encouragement. That's the hope building, right? And then the refer is connect them to a resource. Connect them to a hotline. There's suicide prevention apps now for your phone. You can go onto iTunes. Download an app that walks you right through it. But QPR is just like CPR, except you don't have to push your mouth on anyone. So, that's good. Did that help?
Yeah.
That's QPR in 30 seconds. Okay, what else? Yes.
I'm actually just curious, have you struggled with a thyroid condition at all? No, you haven't?
No, I've had a big test.
Yes. Yes.
So, I danced to the ballet for 14 years. And then I broke my knee. So I'm just curious how you dealt with that loss, more in detail of how you felt. Because I don't think I ever really did that. Because I went to 5 different orthopedic doctors, and they all told me the same thing.
What they said?
Never dance again. Have surgery or 5 years of physical therapy. You can still walk around, but you'll never be able to dance.
He was very specific, you'll never dance again. And of course, I just flicked them off in my head, and I did it anyway. Which only further injured my back. And then I did dance a little bit, but it was nothing compared to ballet. Ballet is like probably the most hard form of dance you could do. And I did go through physical therapy after session. And then of course I had to really drive it home for this doctor who told me I'd never run or do anything physical. So I decided, okay, fine, I'm gonna run 2 marathons. I'm not an overachiever. I ran 2 marathons on my spine, which I should never have done. But it's really important that we do go back and explore those moments and try to put ourselves back in that and allow ourselves to feel what was going on inside our body at the time and not try to fix it or make it go away, but just sit in that. And I can still dance a little bit. You know, I do ballet a little bit, and you know, it's, I know my limitations, and I'm trying to learn to honor my body. It's very difficult because I love to push. So, you know, if I'm going easy, I feel easy. The old dancer.
You talked a lot about teaching like coping skills. What's the most effective one you found for yourself?
For myself?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the biggest one for me personally is sleep. To cope with stress, I need to shut it down and get plenty of sleep and honor when my body's feeling tired. I've taught my daughter that skill. Even with the level of homework in 5th grade, she'll come home and she'll be tired and she'll be trying to do her homework. And she's really struggling. Of course, she's my kid, so she starts beating herself up about it. I have no idea where she saw that. And I'll take, you know what? We're going to stop right now and we're going to go take a rest. Because that's what your brain